Hey guys, what's up? Here's another episode of the Barbell Life, and today we have one of my, who I would consider my mentor, the guy I've looked up to, like any powerlifter of my era. You know, we grew up and we learned by reading all of his articles in Powerlifting USA. I've pretty much read all of his books. I have watched his videos from back in the day, and he truly inspired me to be a better powerlifter, and he also inspired me to be a smarter one. And so it's Louie Simmons. All of you know him. He's Westside Barbell. He is, I would say, undoubtedly has affected more people in the strength conditioning world than any other coach, at least that I know. And so, it's even like my heroes like Joe Ken look up to him. So, he's a legend. So you don't have to agree with him, but you should definitely respect him. And if you want to be the best, I would definitely learn something from him, because, a lot of very good strength and conditioning coaches listen to him. And if you're not very good, then maybe you should consider, listening to him. So, Louie, thanks for being on my show. I appreciate you.
Thank you very much, Travis.
Yeah. So we brought, this weekend, we've already only been here a couple of days so far, but I brought my wife. I brought Jackie Bigger, probably my best female lifter on my team. We brought, Frank, Caleb, Rebecca. So we brought a crew to come up here and learn from, one of the best coaches in America. And we have been blown away. And so let me start by saying this. I know a lot of you coaches out there, I'm talking to weightlifting coaches right now. And I'm talking to some of them who I would consider my friends. And I know there was a lot of negative feedback about the book he wrote. You can say what you want. And yes, has he coached weightlifters before? Maybe not. But I tell you this, in 2 days, I have learned more from him than I've learned from any coach in my entire life. We, Jackie, who's, she's worked with all the great coaches in America now. And she is blown away and so excited. She can't get enough of what we've learned here. And a video that I'm going to put up very soon. You might have already, by the time we air this, you might have already watched it. But in one session with him, she improved her power clean by 5 kilos. And not only improved it, but the way that she improved it. Like, it wasn't like a barely did she, how everyone says, is this a power clean? It was super high and super easy and super fluid. And another thing that, I hear a lot of negative feedback on is that bands or chains will mess up the bar path. Well, watch the videos. I can tell you that the bar path wasn't affected whatsoever. You can watch it with the bands on. You can watch it with the bands off. Nothing was affected. But what was affected was the speed of which she was doing it. And we used the contrast method, right? You know what you call it, Louie? So she started by doing, multiple sets of three on some basically every minute on the minute, roughly.
Before that, she did 25 squats.
Yeah, before that she did. Yeah, before that we had her and Frank on the and I did a few on the box squats and doing it super wide. And I know a lot of people are going to say, well, it doesn't mimic, the catch of the clean or the catch of the snatch. But what it does mimic is the pull, of which Jackie would definitely be served better with a better pull, and it obviously worked. And two, it also addresses a weakness. A lot of weightlifters, which was in your book, are very weak eccentrically, and it's going to help, learn to, number one, when they relax in the bottom, have to learn to contract the hips, which the hips normally don't work at all for weightlifters because they bounce out of the bottom. And so the hips never really have to come into play to get the, to get the bar started. And so it was interesting to see how weak they were off the box. And if nothing else, do it as an exercise to strengthen a weakness. We can all agree that that's a very important, to longevity of the career. Let's say, pretend that you don't want to believe that it'll help her pull. That's fine. But you have to agree that if there's a weakness, if you strengthen the weakness, if nothing else, it will, that will prevent injuries because there's a weakness in the body. So, I sound pretty on point right now.
Pretty on point.
Well, we'll get back to this podcast in just a minute. Don't go anywhere. We got another hour of this interview left, and we'll continue in just a little bit. But really quickly, I'm Lauren Penelis from the Barbell Life podcast with Coach Travis Mash, And I wanted to let you know, just in case you haven't seen it elsewhere, that Travis has just released his brand new resource called No Weaknesses. Now, if you're interested in what Travis and Louie are talking about here, correcting muscular imbalances in order to prevent injury, then you'll definitely want to check out No Weaknesses. Travis was inspired by Louie Simmons and many, many, many other great minds, and he put together this huge resource all about his protocols for dealing with the aches and pains that athletes face, for recovery, and for muscular imbalances. In addition to this huge ebook, there's also a 30-point test to help you pinpoint your unique muscular imbalances. And then in the ebook, Travis walks you through specifically how you can attack and fix those muscular imbalances through the use of assistance work. Now, No Weaknesses is all about helping you prevent injury so that you can stay healthy, work harder, and train longer. If you want to check out that resource, you can grab it over at www.mashelites.com/no-weaknesses. Now, right now, we're going to go ahead and get back to this podcast as Coach Travis continues his talk with the great Louie Simmons.
But actually, the hips, the reason we do box squats is to build hip thrust for the explosion part of the pull, the second pull.
Right.
And I promised you, I promised people that I would break their clean record in 1.5 hour, and I do it every time.
Sure,
I see people can't break. I watched a woman crying on a video, said she hadn't broke a record in a year. It takes me 1.5 hour to break. You had two people, and they both broke 2 records in 1.5 hour.
And they weren't rookie lifters. I mean, no. Jackie's one of the best in all of America.
And that's after 25 squats with a combination of band weight at 75% and plus then 15 pulls at a combination of 70%. Then they broke the record.
40. So basically 40 sets.
Yes.
And then the record was broken. She actually broke it twice because she broke it and then broke it again. And really, we could have kept going, but, you know, like you even say, like, leave it in the tank.
I would say 5 more Ks.
Yeah.
But we like to be trained optimally, never train minimally, and never train maximally. Train optimally.
I love the word, and I've always, one of the several things I've taken away from you is, you know, it's about optimal performance. It's about optimal mobility. It's about everything being optimal, nothing ever too extreme.
I'd like to say one thing. I know it doesn't bother me if people criticize me. I trained 2 Olympic gold medal sprinters. I trained a UFC heavyweight champion. The top 5 rugby teams in the entire world use our program. I trained the only team in the Premier League that went 26-0. The only team ever. He also, Richards won 5 titles. And I've worked with NFL teams. They give me 40 ball players. So if you can imagine a salary of 40 NFL ball players, I did it with the Browns, the Seattle Seahawks, and Green Bay Packers. But you, thank God, Travis, are the first one that would bring me a weightlifter. They must be priceless. They're too priceless to bring to me because something may happen, like make progress.
Right. You know, I can say this because I'm a weightlifting coach too, is that it's weird how it would appear that in America, the weightlifting coaches are the most prideful coaches I've ever seen. I mean, like he said, the Olympic coaches, matter of fact, Ohio State's, you know, one of their track coaches was here this morning. So that's okay. You know, Joe Kinn, the Carolina Panthers, you know, head strength coach, he'll come. You know, he makes, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars, but he sees that, you know, he sees the value in Louie Simmons. But we, you know, a sport that is not producing. I mean, I'm calling myself out right now. We are not producing, but we think that we've got it. Maybe, just maybe, we need to look in the mirror and say, what we're doing is not working. So if we keep doing the same thing, guess what? It's going to be the same results.
In 1981, the latter part, I broke my lower back for the second time. I couldn't lay down for 17 weeks. I said, there must be a better way. So I went to Bud Chikonigan and got all the books. And Bud says, well, these books are classroom books. And I said, that's exactly what I need. I need to learn, you know, my true sport. All the methodologies that I use for my sport, which had broke approximately 140 all-time world records. There are 4 world record holders in my gym currently. Right. It came from weightlifting methodologies from the old Soviet Union. And the Bulgarian, it's a mixture. It's all weightlifting methodologies that I use for my sport. And so the people say, well, what a conjugate system work? It came from weightlifting, from the Dynamo Club in 1972. And a lot of people don't know, but the Dynamo Club also had 46 sports. Not only weightlifting, but it contributed. Dr. Medvedev and Verfershansky ran that as long as A.S. Primlin. Many people have heard of Primlin's chart. Primlin was a junior national coach for the Soviet Union for 75 to 80, and a senior coach from 80 to 85. He had some of the strongest weightlifters that ever came out of Russia, and that's how he came up with his charts, which immediately I've started to follow Premlin's charts, and it changed my complete career back in 1982.
See, now, in the records that you speak of breaking, that's not even coming, you know, even scratching the surface of the records that have been broken because people use your principles. Where, you know, like me, I read your stuff. So I didn't have a coach. I'll be honest. I never had a powerlifting coach. So the closest thing I had to a coach was him. I will say this. At the meets, he always helped me. I don't know if you know this, but in 2004 when I broke Ed Cohn's all-time world record, you're in the background with me. It was the coolest thing. Like, I got to show you the video, but no one else ever coached me but him. And so you have to attribute the world records I broke. I have to give credit to him because no one else helped me. Only person I had to read or go to was him. So, and I'm not the only one. You walk in any powerlifting gym in America, I would say at least 90%, and you will definitely see elements. I would say 100%. You will see elements that only way they got it was from him. You know, you see somebody doing a good morning, you see a box squat, you see a band, you see a chain, you see a board. I mean, they came out a floor press, you know, a dumbbell tricep extension, you know, I can go on and on, you know, JM presses came from him. So he's being really modest when he talks about the records that he can attribute to Westside Barbell.
Especially overseas. We're bigger overseas than we are in America. We're huge in Russia, huge in Finland, huge in Australia, huge everywhere, huge in Ireland. You know the weightlifter in Ireland that does these principles, and you can, I saw him snatch 396 and
jeez,
and clean and jerk around what 490 or
that's what
496 I think it is at 220.
Yeah,
yeah. All Westside methods. He backs me up when people badmouth me.
Yeah, I know.
I'm not going to argue with anyone. They'd want to do it.
I thought it was very funny, like the way you responded to John Coffey. It was very, your response was very elegant and eloquent. I guess eloquent, not elegant. There's nothing elegant about it. What?
I truly don't think. I mean, John's not here to defend himself, but I don't think John ever read my book. You read my book. Those are not powerlifting exercises. Those are weightlifting exercises.
Weightlifting.
I never mentioned low bar squat. That went out 25 years ago.
Right.
We carried a bar in our traps like everybody else.
Yep.
You know, and you just it's strange how things.
I know Chuck Vogelpool was the first one that I saw to do like he just carried the bar like every like a weightlifter would carry it. Which then I was like, sweet, because I always hated the low bar because, it hurt my shoulders. And so I was like, I'm just going to squat like everyone else. And so it really helped me with my bench. My bench was able to shoot up because I didn't crush my shoulders from doing low bar.
You know, the squat is critical. When people always come here, I say, I promise I'll break your clean record. 9 times out of 10, I do it. 9 times out of 10, they can't recover if they do a full clean. I realized right away that weightlifters have no squat. Right. That's why I suggest the box squat. I mean, Chuck Vogelpohl's never done a full squat. Dave Hoff's never done a full squat in the gym. Yet they are the greatest pound-for-pound squatter in the world. Chuck did 1180 at 264. And then Dave, his training partner, did 1210 at 271. So we have the two greatest squatters. And I predict I will have a 165 who just squatted 890. He will become the greatest squatter of all time. And if you go overseas... what the hell's his name? Is the world record in the 132s is in Ireland? It's 749. I can't think of my boy's name. And then 806.
I do that all the time.
That's our guy. It's all Westside.
That's awesome. Well, I will tell you this morning when I was here. You know, and I don't want it to be about like look what he's done, but like I have to say this morning. In the gym, I saw two girls who run track at Ohio State, one of which has just graduated, who's is about to sign a pro contract, his first, track and field. I saw an MMA fighter. I saw the Ohio State track and field coach. I mean, all this morning, not to mention all the powerlifters. I saw my buddy Jason Coker, the crazy adopted son, pretty much. And so, but it was... I'll tell you this, too, is like this morning reminded me of like the mentality I had when I was, a competitor. And I swear I don't know what it is, but I had lost that until this morning. And like when I go back, I will tell you like things are going to change. Like for some reason, I've just been in weightlifting so long, I've gotten soft. I'll take full responsibility. But the minute I walked in Westside Barbell, I don't know if it's the culture, the people, the music, Louie, whatever it is, I changed, and I was like, it was like I was 30 years old or 25 years old again, and I was, I just wanted to win, and I wanted to, you know, I wanted, my wife said, chill out, she could see my face changing, but that's the, that is the atmosphere that you guys need, that all weightlifters need. Right now, it's so soft. I'm going to be on, I'm going to call out my own sport. We are soft. When we go to the gyms, I mean, just the looks on our face, or if somebody walks in front of us when we clean the gym, we're going to cry about it. That is so soft. You know, if you're a competitor and you're a winner and you want to be the best and you want to be an Olympic champion, you got to not be soft. You got to be hard. There should be nothing that can get in your way, nothing that can stop you from being the best. You know, but it's just the culture in America has gotten weak. And I will say at Westside Barbell, there is not, and it wasn't just the powerlifters. It was the darn girls. I mean, the girls are like, it's a different, if you haven't been here, even if you don't like them, pretend you do, come here, visit, and just watch, and just experience the culture, and the culture alone. If you don't learn anything that I learned, which is fine, because I enjoy beating all you guys, but like, if you don't want to learn what I learned, just look at the culture and learn about that.
Coaches, it's not about you. It is about your lifters. You have to be unselfish. I go to great means. This gym costs me over $50,000 a year, and this is a private gym. And I bring people. No one pays me anything. I pay everything. I pay for records, and you know. And the idea, my whole gym is about one thing: making Westside Barbell stronger. When someone breaks a record, it's like putting two more bricks on top of the wall for you have to crawl inside.
Right.
And that's all my whole life is about making people stronger, or run faster, or beat people up.
You know, I will say this: I saw a lot of my old friends, some of the powerlifters like Jason. And every last one of them was talking about how they could break the next record. Like Jason now, he's my age, and so he's beat up, he's worn. So now his goal is he thinks at 181 that, you know, he has a good chance of breaking the record so he can get on that daggone board. Like, that board is like everything to those lifters. I mean, like, that's all of them they talk about. Yeah, it's just chalk.
Get chalk.
But to them, it's blood.
It's got to be.
Yeah. And so they were all talking about how they wanted the big guy, the 308 that was in there this morning, the tall
Christian.
Yeah, he was talking about, like, he was thinking about going to super heavy because that number was a little bit less than Dave Hoff's number at 308. So he thought he would go up to super heavy because he'd have a better chance of getting on the board. It's all they talked about was, how do I get on the board?
So. And you saw one of our 900-pound deadlifters. You know, this is common. We've had four. Our top, back strength, Olympic lifters need back strength. Our top 10 deadlift average is 866 pounds. Top five is 890. I've had seven women deadlift over 500.
But
one of them's a 148.
But I thought you couldn't teach people deadlifts.
Right, that's what everyone said.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's all, we'll get into training later. It's all about volume.
You're the best
deadlift. Volume, how do you do it?
You're the best deadlift coach that people have said suck. I mean, I don't know what else to say. But, yeah, I saw the dude who deadlifts 900, and, you know, also the look on people's faces, like, they were there to do work. Like nobody really smiled. Like, people were there to do work. Everybody had the same look. It looked crazy. It's like they were robots. Everybody walked in the gym with the most scowled, like, serious, focused look on their face.
You know, the track girls did the same program that the powerlifters did, you know, for the squat before they did their general conditioning for running. And it's the same thing. You wouldn't know they're not, other than being tall and skinny, you wouldn't know they're track girls.
Yeah, even the MMA guy, that dude. Mm-hmm. I tell you this, you know, if you don't believe that Westside is all about volume, this dude, when he got here and when he put his gear on and started to go to work, he did not stop moving, and he didn't talk to one person. He didn't do anything until he was done, and then the dude was a nice guy, came over to me, hey, you know, nice to meet you. He was such a nice guy. But all right, so the first big point I want to get, you know, enough of, you know, me pointing my finger. I'm a little jacked right now, so I've called everyone out, so I'm sure you all hate me, but look, I still love you guys. I'm jacked, so forgive me. But it's the accessory movements. I know that, you know, you said at least 50% of your work should be accessory movements.
And, you know, a book I reference a lot is the Managing the Training of Weightlifters. It distinctly says in there that as you become proficient at weightlifting, you have to do at least 50% of training consists of assistant work. And because, you know, why did prelim have a chart? If you look at Primlin's chart, he talks about weights. Now, our average training weight is 80%, much like right. the Chinese. If you were to look at my training, it models exactly the Chinese program,
right.
Even though I'm a powerlifter. But, you know, 80% weights. Well, the optimal number of lifts per workout would be 15. So we pay attention to the optimal. Actually, for us, we normally do the maximal.
Right.
And because you want to grow from minimal to maximal if you can handle the program. But why does he have, like, for instance, you know, we'll say the maximal at 70% is 24 lifts. And 80 is 20, and above 90 is 10. Well, the whole problem with Olympic weightlifting or any sport, you have to raise volume. So how can you raise volume if you had to stop at these numbers? The answer is spatial pulls. Spatial pulls and squats. That's what they would do. You know, a lot of people talk about Nam Suleiman said all they did was clean jerk snatch, clean jerk. No, they did not. One day he would do, for instance, around 24 pulls. The next day about 24 classical lifts, then 24 pulls, next day it switched back and forth. Some days he didn't do any classical lifts. So, you know, before you talk about the ball games, do some real research and find out. I had the Olympic weightlifting team doctor for the Bulgarian weightlifting team here with me. We had a huge discussions. I've been very fortunate having people like this. The Jamaican track strength coach for the track club. I mean, I have people like this come see me.
Wait. I just want you guys to hear that. That is the best track and field coach in the world.
Right.
Came here, but we don't.
Coach.
But we don't want to.
The strength coach. Yes. And he was amazed. He watched an 18-year-old girl jump on a 55-inch box, and he just could not believe what he'd seen.
That's pretty impressive. I mean, yeah, that kind of hurts my feelings a little bit.
Yeah, the blonde you saw this morning could jump on 55 too. So.
Yeah, well, I saw how explosive she was, so it doesn't...
You know, and a key to weightlifting, I was telling Travis, you know, you had said, well, I watch the squats. But see, I monitor everything. Why does the car have a tachometer? You know, we'll say your car shifts to 2,500. Why not 2,000? Why not 35? Why not 42? Because there's optimal horsepower. So when you train, you need to have... The bar should be at optimal bar velocity. And so I know that for speed strength... why do I use our the greatest weightlifters, 780 cases of highly qualified weightlifters, 50% of the training was between 75 and 85%.
Right.
So I read that and said, well, if it's good enough for them, it'll be good enough for me.
Right.
Because this is 82, and what was the rap? You're not even old on me. But the rap was powerlifters are slow.
Right.
And I go, you know what? We are. And this is what happened. I said, yes, we're slow. By doing speed strength training, you know, 24 squats every week, we became very explosive. And then after a year and a half, I realized the problem with weightlifters. They can't lift slow weights.
Right.
And by that, as barbells become heavier, of course, velocity slows down. And you had to produce greater force at that point. That's Hill's equation of muscle contraction.
Strength speed.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you have no strength speed. So, I mean, I've seen guys do sets and jump 10 pounds and can't do a single.
And I have to, yeah.
Right, okay. And that's when I realized that they had to be able to lift heavy weights, and they could not do that. One, lack of strength. But how do you get it? Through spatial means. One spatial mean is what you saw this morning by using the bands.
Right.
Because enormous amount of bands will slow the barbell down.
Right.
And so if you've got a 300-pound power clean, that's one max. But I can give you five ways to break that record, your strength record, not with the power clean.
Right.
Because you just can't come in and power clean over and over like people do, because that's called the law of accommodation. If you repeat the same activities, the same training weights, the same volume intensity, you go backwards.
I mean, I totally agree. You know, even in our gym, you know, the biggest thing is you know, changing. You know, when I say conjugate, like, I'm very broad in that term, you know, but, like, we change everything. Even the way we squat, you know, we change. You know, we might front squat, but then we might do a pause front squat. We might do, you know, we might do a back squat. We might do a 5-second eccentric, but it's completely always changing. The way we max, you know, is going to be, we might do a complex where it's like a pull to a, you know, but we don't just snatch, clean, jerk all the time. You know, we do try to work on weaknesses. And I'll tell you that Jackie does the best job of following the program. And as you can see, even you agreed, her work capacity is through the roof. And she was able to, you know, today she was able to roll through the workout really good. And I didn't know if I told them, but the record she hit was a 100K, a 220-pound, you know, clean power clean. And I mean, she caught it super high, yeah, which was 5 kilos above her all-time best. And when she did 95 kilos, it was like one of those borderline things. And she smoked it. Like, she is Jackie is 100% sold, and she's like, she's my best athlete. Like, I have no doubts that Jackie will be on the podium at the American Open, and I have no doubts that in 4 years she's going to be going for the Olympics. So
that's my goal. That's my goal for the Olympic weightlifting sport, is for Travis to get people qualified for the Olympics and get a medal.
Yeah.
Because we excel. You know, a lot of coaches don't like me because I did not say that they're not good coaches. I said they're adequate technique coaches, but they have no idea about how to make someone stronger. And I was at a seminar one time, and you were there too, Travis.
Yeah.
And a gentleman said, strength doesn't matter.
If strength doesn't matter,
why do you have weight classes? Why won't a 123 lift what a super heavyweight does? This is insane to me.
Because a lot of people don't get that analogy, but if you don't get that analogy, how are you a coach? Like, if strength doesn't matter, why does the little person not lift as much as the heavy person? Because they're not as strong. They're way faster. Okay. I guarantee they're way faster.
And maybe better technique.
And always better. The little dudes are always better technique.
Right.
And they obviously can't lift as much because the bigger dudes are stronger.
We emphasize small lifters must be much stronger in the legs and hips, you know, because they have to make up for small errors in technique. Where a large man, because of large mass, he can correct a small error with
right.
no problem. But like a thinner person has to be very strong to correct error. So
yeah.
We train smaller people slightly different than larger.
That brings me to another point with accessory movements. You talked about, like, you know, putting people in awkward, you know, positions.
Yes, and you know, this morning, you know, I've had some very specialized. The Russians, when Russia, at first I read about Vary Borzov, and they say, Vary, what do you need? He was Olympic champion twice in sprints years ago. And basically he would say, harder workout. That's all he would ever say. So they would come up with a new exercise, like that's where the Kapan Glue came from. Him and Alexis came up about the same time. And so, like I told you this morning, I have special machines.
Right.
You know, guys, I've said this at Olympic lifters. You're not going to the county fair. You're trying to go to the Olympics.
I totally agree.
You can't just have a pair of freaking weightlifting shoes and think that's going to get you there.
Yeah.
But and people say, well, we live on these 80% of our training in special exercise. I have a stat person. I've done people, a girl that could not qualify for hip tapalon for 6 years. It's a 26-year-old girl. Her coach brings her in, tells me the problem. I got her 9 weeks. First meets qualifies for hip tapalon. I never ran track. I don't know anything about track, but I know power and strength. And so I know how to do these things. So that's how we operate.
And can I say this too? Like this morning, after they did the squats and then they did the contrast methods with the cleans, then he started putting them on, you know, the machines he's talking about. One was the belt squat, which they, you know, the belt squat is amazing. Like, which we're actually going to get a belt squat machine. I know, we're so excited because it's so versatile. Like, for example, Frank did the belt squat, with doing the neck too, and his little neck is so sore, he couldn't handle it. But the girls were doing it.
Right, we do good mornings with a neck harness. We do power cleans, push jerks while with the belts around your waist. Now people say, people's always said to me, well, why would you do that? Well, this is why, because I watched Russian world champions do it, so I copied it.
Yeah.
I watched the Chinese do things. I copy it. If I was to say to do a snatch grip deadlift until you're back rounded and continue until you couldn't go to the ground, they would say I'm completely crazy.
China
Coach
wouldn't.
Fang says the very thing.
I've read the exact same thing.
Coach Fang said when you squat, you should incline forward because you're going to be bent over somewhat forward.
Right.
Because what gives out basically in those lifts, it's actually the back, not the legs.
Right. Now, I've said exactly. Even with me, you know, when I was a powerlifter, I never worried about my legs not being able to squat the weight. It was like, could my back support it or not? So when I tried 1,000 first time, I was just like, I just hope my back can stand up.
One thing you must recognize: why do you miss lifts? You know, this book will tell you why. It'll tell you the 10 most reasons you'll miss a lift. And so read the back of this book and find out. One of them is incompletion of back extension.
Right.
All right. So you notice when the guys got off the bands, they had back extension they'd never had before.
Totally.
And this is literally in probably 20 minutes.
Even me too. Like, you know, it really launched. Like, after I took the bands off, like, I mean, it left my hands.
Yeah. You about knocked your teeth
out. I hit my my chin. And it was not light. It wasn't because it was so light. It was because it just my pull was able to accelerate at a much greater and a much higher point. So, and those, I was going to say before we move, I don't want to forget those machines. So we went and we found that some of them were weak on the belt machine. Some of them were weak on the inverse hybrid. However, I will say for the big, you know, the one that we were able to do the most was the inverse hybrid. So our hamstrings and glutes.
Inverse curl.
Yeah, the inverse curl. Hamstring yeah.
Machine.
Yeah. We were able to do pretty good on that, you know, even, and Jackie was able, he said she did better than anyone's ever done the first time. But what they were super as a whole week on was the reverse hyper and some of the things that we were having them do. Just their low backs. And I've evidently, I can say I've done a poor job of preparing their low backs because they were all weak.
All right. You know, I didn't realize when I done it, I have 11 patents. And that when someone wants to improve, I would come up with a way to make them improve. I come up with a new machine. And invariably, they would pull more or, you know, squat or bench.
Right.
But also, I realized that these machines, what they do, they have, where it's hard for you or me, you know, if your guy pulls them deadlifting, I know why people miss, you know, if it's at the knees, it's lower back, your hips are far away, at the top, it's glutes, can't get off the ground, it's normally knee flexion, abdominal work.
Right.
All right. So when these machines, they evaluate your strength.
Right.
So like we found out when he put his top girl on the reverse hyper, she was very weak in lower back, blew her lower back up. She's touched muscles she'd never touched.
She did.
And on the hamstring machine, the inverse curl is the most fabulous hamstring. It makes glute hams obsolete.
Yeah, it sure does.
So I can evaluate people's strength with these spatial machines where no one else can. You know, you can put cameras on them forever. You're not going to tell what's really missing the weights.
Right. I mean, that was what's cool because, you know, in the gym, I'm always trying to visually find the weakness. But the machines quantify that. They leave no doubt. They're like, you know, Jackie, by the way, just walked in the room. We've been talking about you the whole time about and so, but we found that her low back is just super weak. And so, if you got to think about this, the low back is the pivot point of everything in weightlifting, the snatch, the clean, the jerk. And so, imagine if now I target that low back, what's going to happen, you know?
Many people in weightlifting, this came from weightlifting, the Soviets, they would call it a web. And this web consisted of, like a 110K lifter would have to back squat so much, he would have to front squat so much, he'd have to burst jerk, actually close grip bench back then, 418.
Wow.
And it was a web. So, and how many lifts could he possibly do in a month's training? And so if you did this web, and that's how we train our powerlifters, I talk about it in my bench and squat manuals. If you look at the web, if you cannot do the adequate amount of weights at a certain percent, or if you can't front squat, you know, it was 628. A front squat, bottom, 628 got you barely past. So if you couldn't front squat, you know, you were not a good lifter. You were missing part of this web. Mm.
That's awesome. You know.
It's in a book called Fitness for Life by Bergoglio, and it's a very, very good book, but it's very, very hard to find.
Well, you found it.
And so, I found
thank
it.
Thank God. I researched.
Yeah. What history is the greatest of lifting? Weightlifting.
Right.
It's been going on forever.
Right.
You know, the Russians all came up with all this type of research. And so I constantly refer to Russian training as far back as 1937,
right,
or even when periodization began. I use weight periodization, the greatest periodization I've ever seen.
Right.
A lot of people's never heard of it. But like for team sports, for instance, if you want a rugby team to squat 400 pounds, all you have to do is train your weights that's with 25% band tension at 50, 55, and 60, so right, it relates to 75, 80, and 85. It, with those weights of maximum acceleration.
Pendulum wave, right?
Yes, you have the ability to squat 400 pounds, the force,
right,
to knock you on your butt.
Right.
And you know, so, like NFL ball, you want your lineman to squat 700, be able to do that. If they train at 350 and to 420, they will have, at a maximum acceleration, about 0.8 meters per second at least, at 0.8 or 9, they will have, they're developing the force of a 700-pound squat.
Right.
So you say, well, big deal. No, let's wait here. If a guy can squat 700 pounds one time,
right,
but what if I got you to do 24 exertions of 700 pounds? That's why the pendulum wave is far superior to all sports.
Right. And the cool thing about, you know, for football, you know, I want to throw this out for you strength and conditioning coaches. I don't want to spend the whole time throwing down on my colleagues, but so the is that you're able to do, you know, like work at, you know, 700 pound percentages without killing them, you know, because they got to play in the game.
Have your readers heard of force equals mass times acceleration? Yes. People ask me, what book should I buy first? And I say, a physics book. Has anyone thought of Newton's laws of motion?
I did see your beginner physics book over there. Yeah.
That's right. Very important. How do you increase kinetic energy? By increasing velocity or mass? Right. You know the answer to that. Right. You know, it's velocity. And you need to know these things. That's why I use bands, overspeed eccentrics.
Right.
Faster down, faster up. You don't believe me? Drop a basketball. How high is a band? Still down. How high is a band?
Right.
And that ball, the elastic properties of that ball, is much like the soft tissue in a body. That's why my track girls, they do 200 leg curls every day. All right? I make them walk on tires. Why?
I saw it.
Actually, a couple of your people here did it.
Yeah.
It thickens the ligaments and tendons, and that's where the kinetic energy
goes in your body. Ligaments and tendons, it takes very high reps for those
to work. Watch a fat person run a marathon, say how they do it? Reusable energy in the soft tissue.
Wow.
That's exact. It's human locomotion and reusable energy.
All right. So let me ask you this specific question. So since we're still on accessory movements, if you were a weightlifting coach, like throw out some accessory movements that, you know, you think, obviously it'll be dependent on what strength and weakness, but just throw out some common ones you think we should do.
You have to push the back raise. I had a coach here and they had a lifter and they said he only did 25. I was doing 225 for 5 in a back raise. And wow. They were doing 95. That's all they could do. And I'm going like, this is insane. I was 50-some years old. And actually, the guy was bigger than I was.
You did 225. Only other person I've ever heard doing that would be Alexia. I know that he did 100 kilos from, you know, reps.
Yeah. Well, I watched in 1970, the world champions here in Columbus, Ohio. My friend Jimmy Benjamin, national champion. He's competing against Walmart Bazanowski.
Wow.
He became the Polish coach. I went up there and watched Walmart, and I think he's probably taller than me. I'm 5'5".
Right.
But 148, I watched him do 100K for sets of 5 in the back raise, all the way down and up with an arch.
Wow.
And I'm going like, because he had a 386 clean, it might have been right around the world record, and he was a split cleaner at that time. People actually split clean back then. And my friend Jimmy's best was like 347. And Jimmy could match him in the hand clean, but he couldn't match him in the full clean.
Right.
And that was why. You know, he had a greater amount of absolute strength.
Yeah, my brain is going crazy. All right, so back raises. What are some others?
A back reverse hyper is obvious, but why would you do back raise reverse hyper? People don't know what, you know, I've heard. Here's one of my pet peeves. A great book I saw said you don't need a reverse hyper. You don't need a glute ham. Why, you nuts? You people need these exercises.
Why would you not need them?
That's what I want to know. Why wouldn't you need them?
I mean,
I don't understand it.
I will say this. Before we go on, like if you have a weakness, you know, say you're a weightlifter and you snatch, you clean and jerk. If you have a weakness and you've been snatching, clean and jerking for, you know, 5 years, you're not going to improve that weakness of snatching, clean and jerk. I mean, you've already been doing it. Like, use your head. You got to target that weakness. Yes.
You know, Bonachok, I'm sure a lot of you have heard of Bonachok, the shot put giant, you know, world champ, trained about 11 world. He has books, and one of them is called Transfer of Exercise. And what he says is, like a friend of mine, Sakari, has got Bull Farm. You've heard of Bull Farm, I'm sure. Strongest gym in Finley. They do all of our stuff, and, you know, and then we trade records back and forth, world records. But he said it does no good to be strong in the wrong exercise, which absolutely means the same thing. So as a lifter or coach, I look at it as a piece of pie. Like Jackie here, if Jackie came to me for a while, I realized right away, I could look at her and see, and it came out true. Her very lower back is the weakest thing on her, correct, Jackie, you'd say. So when Jackie would get done, that's the first thing she would do. I would get the biggest piece of pie on her lower back. And let's say, if her traps was the strongest, that'd be the last thing I train. I'd train the least amount, but I'd still train it. And then why would I do that? Because I eliminate muscle imbalances. We don't have any injuries. We don't even have sore. These people's ready to go to me today, you know. How do you feel? I feel great. You got any pains? No.
That's true. The only one that was really talking about hurting was the guy who didn't follow your
That's
direction.
One guy doesn't follow, and he's always banged up.
Yeah.
It's living proof that I like it because it proves to me our stuff.
A funny story. My friend Jason Coker, who is like – will be like a brother for my life. And like he even said, you know, he's talking about, oh, this hurts, that hurts. And I was like, you know, Jason, you really should listen to what Louis says. And he's like, Travis, I even know I should listen to Louis. I know he's brilliant. I'm just too dumb, is what he said. He said, I am too hard-headed. And I'm like, all right. I mean, what do you say to that? All right, man. But the other people who were, you know, had listened to him, everyone was fine. You know, everyone's that MMA guy, that dude, that I've never seen in my lifetime.
We got a lot of
them. I've never seen anything like that. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I had a stat person. He did an internship here. He actually stayed, like a lot of interns. He stayed. He's been here like 4 or 5 years now. Like Tom, it runs my business, yeah. Actually. But he came and saw his job was, and this is with track people, this is with fighters, and this is with lifters. I had him graph the amount of barbell training we do and amount of assisted exercise. We do 20% with a barbell and 80% small spatial exercise. The small spatial exercise, in my opinion, is the most important. And you know the Chinese, I don't like the word term bodybuilding, but they say at the end of every workout, they do 2 bodybuilding exercises. You see them doing dips, you see them doing side bends.
You see them doing it push-ups. At the Olympics. You know, where everyone else is, you know, doing just snatch, clean and jerk, those dudes, you know, I'll say this. When I was at the Junior Worlds and they walked in, number one, my mouth dropped because of how awesome they looked. And number two, you know, they killed everybody. And number three, they were the ones in the back doing all the special exercises that you said, which you said should be, you know, like you might deload, you know, for powerlifting, you might deload squat, bench, and deadlift, but you don't deload the special exercise.
Right. You know, everybody drops assisted exercise. So if you did back raises or you did high pulls and it raised your lifts, why would you drop them before the most important events? It made no sense. I realized right. This way back in the 70s. They say, oh, you got to drop extensions and, yeah. You know, drop back work. So I did. I'm going to meet. I felt like an empty blanket. You
I
know?
Didn't either. Yeah. After I read, you know, you said that in Powerlifting USA years ago. Mm-hmm. And so neither did I. Right. And so, because I know before I was turned on to you, I don't know what I was doing. I was thinking I was following just some basic periodization, and I would do what everyone else did. At the last maybe 4 weeks, I would just squat, bench, and deadlift, and I would always feel terrible at a meet. And so then when I did what you said, I felt, you know, jacked and ready to go and became a world champion. So.
Years ago, Travis, you know Chuck Vogelpohl, and you know I had some yeah. monsters. I had yeah. 3 world record holders in squat and yeah. 3 in the bench in the same yeah. gym. You know, some total – Greg Pinard broke about 7 total world records. Hoff's got a bunch. We got yeah. – you know, we're killing. But we're going through the meet, and we're all about 100 pounds off our best lifts. And I'm going like, well, I know I'm not choking.
Yeah.
And I never seen Chuck – none of these guys choke. I go, why? The squat training was unbelievable. Our squats can always went up, but the bench might be there and the deadlift wasn't. And this didn't mean everyone. I mean, my bench might be good, and like Tate's bench was off. You know, so you never knew. It was a crap game, and so I said, why? And I mean, I had to figure this out. This is driving me crazy. So a year and a half, I studied, and I came up with delayed transformation.
Right.
It came from Verfashansky from track and field and some weightlifting. Medvedev, the Russian weightlifting coach, the Bulgarian weightlifting coach. Well, there's a big feud about who came up with it, but basically
the one that Medvedev is the one I've read came yeah, up with. Exactly. You're talking like most people call it super compensation.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people call it that.
Beat yourself to death, yeah. then recover and become
book
awesome.
It's called delayed transformation. You're right. Okay, yeah. It's the same thing. All right. So what I do a double delayed transformation, and I know I've watched weightlifters, and I believe they do it. Like I hear all they take near world records 2 days before in a training hall. I have no idea why. It'd be like, why would I fight Mike Tyson 2 days before beating up Cicely Tyson?
Well, I will say this. You know, almost all the good ones, even China and Russia, even though you might see that, they have definitely dropped volume somewhere.
Oh, yeah. Yes. I think they do it for a mental. They try to psych out the other countries.
Well, they do a good job.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. And Manam Suleiman, they would have Nam come in. He would power clean more than his competition could actually clean.
That son of a gun.
And so then it would push. Then they would decide the last minute, as you well know. They might push 2 lifters into another weight class because they knew they couldn't beat him anyhow.
Yeah.
But my delay, this is what changed my gym dramatically. I use a double delayed transformation. 28 days out, we'll make sure we only train at 50% with the bands, which is a joke for my guys. 21 days out. That's when we take, it's called Circumax. We take a record on a box squat. We always, and we never miss. They never miss. They break a record. All right? And then 14 days out, they'll do 75% of what they did on Circumax Day. 7 days out, the little guys will do a, you know, some sets with about 50% of their squat with no bands or anything on a box. And then they go to the meet and they constantly break all their records. My last guy, 800 squat at 165.
You know, I finally, you talk so fast. Now I finally got it. So after seeing you write it down, you talk so fast.
Oh, I'm sorry. I know I do.
Man, I'm from the South.
Okay.
We're slow.
Okay. All right. You want to run this again?
No, I got it now.
Okay. This is absolutely important. And it came from track and field and weightlifting. All right. It works for anybody. And I gave you guys examples because we were on a microphone yesterday. AJ Roberts. AJ broke 3 all-time total records, put 455 pounds on his total 3 years here. His best lift, it was 28.55. His best lift was 29.30. He could easily broke the all-time, it could have been my top lifter, which I have, Dave Hoff. But I'm going to give you examples of how accurate this is. On the Circumax day, this is 21 days out, he did 740 pounds on the bar and 440 pounds a band. That is 1,180 pounds at lockout. We have a lot of band tension in the bottom, as they found this morning.
Right.
All right. 4 weeks before that, we did a strength phase where I consider strength more band than you can use weight. So he did 700 pounds of band.
What week is this?
This is about a month or 5 or 6 weeks before the Circumax.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Right. We'll do 2 Circumax a year because we go to 2 meets. You know, I like to go only 2 full meets and then maybe a bench meet or push pull. And then 2 strength phases, 4 massive, extreme, super maximal workouts, things they've never done.
Right.
All right. So, on the strength phase, they use more bands than they can use weight. So, we load up 700 pound of band, which is way harder than 700 pound of weight. And then he made 510 pounds of weight. So, that comes up to 1,210. So remember, with the 440 band, is 1,180. AJ squatted 1,205 pounds at the meet. I showed you my Circumax. This is
I was at the meet when he did that. I was, you know, I was coaching at that point still, but I saw it.
I mean, how close can you come? This is retardedly close. My last boy, he went from, I promised him, he came here 800 squat top there is right now in the 165s anywhere, currently, and 880 total, 1,880 total top there is. In the country.
I got a question. So, like, when you did 700 bands.
Yep.
What would you call that? Would you call that speed strength?
No, that's strength speed.
Strength
slow
speed.
Slow strength. All right. You know, the velocities are actually around 0.4, maybe, you know, around 0.4 meters per second.
All right.
And I think that's what you guys got to do because, like I said, when you get to heavy weights, they can't move them.
Look, I know this is a podcast and I'm supposed to be the host, but I'm taking notes too. This is about me too. It's not just about you. Okay. Mostly about you.
Where are we at here?
All right, so the strength speed is where we ended.
Yeah, and see, so most of our training is for speed strength. So, I mean, if you got a calculator and you take, now we're doing 25 lifts. So if you take 85% of 1,210 times 25, that's his squat volume.
Right.
Add that up, someone. It's enormous. Now, and we do 21 deadlifts.
Yeah.
Well, for around 80%. All right?
Yeah.
So, see, and the deadlifts are bars already loaded. They immediately go from the squatting to the deadlifting. So, it's an enormous amount of barbell volume on that day. Very high volume, moderate intensity.
Right.
It's 75 to 85%. 72 hours later is our max effort day.
Right.
And the only difference between what I do and I think you should do, we do one max. We'll rack pull,
right,
or low box squat with a spatial bar or a box, stand on a box or whatever we do, but we max out. The volume is very low.
Right.
Like I had a kid that had a 900 deadlift, but you know, this would be a record, but he squatted right at 1,100, 1,085.
Right.
So it's a high-volume day for speed day. But when he pulled 805 standing on a mat, which is an all-time record, basically, if you look at it, it's like 405. He did 405 for one, then like 515 for one, 605 for one, 705 for one, and 805 for one. So you're talking, you know, 15, 23, 28. It's lucky to be 3,000 pounds.
Right.
And have you heard of the rule of 60? This is a weightlifting. the next workout should be 60% of the volume of the other workout.
Oh, yeah, I have. Well, okay. I've heard you say that, but yeah. I haven't heard it for weightlifters. But
okay,
yeah.
Well, it's just weightlifters. It came from weightlifters. See, ours is probably the rule of 35 because we make much larger jumps. That's the only – you guys make, smaller jumps. So you're going to get a lot more sets in there, but our jumps are enormous, and it's over within 10 minutes.
Right.
But so my point is – I would have weightlifters, I'm sure you can do this, 2 max efforts on max every day.
Yeah,
it could be a pull and a push.
That's what we do now.
Yeah, exactly. Good.
Yeah,
that's what I would do. Because you could handle it. But then it's into all that assistance exercise.
Right. So, and then the assistance, you still keep that volume
huge.
High. Yeah.
It's like, a lot of people think on speed day we do less efforts. No. I mean, we do as much as we can on both days.
I will say this, Jackie does the most assistance work of anyone in my gym, and she has seen the most improvement than any other athlete. I mean, she came to me in March. It was March of this year. It was when Muscle Driver, their thing fell down, and so she came to me having set 0 records in a year there. And so she came to me, and literally, March now. It's what? It's August. In that time, her clean and jerk has gone up 15 kilos. Her snatch has gone up 10. So you got 25 kilo in, 6 months. Is that even 6 months? April, May, June, July. 5 months. She's gone up 55 pounds, and that's a lot. In weightlifting, that's a lot.
But basically, kind of a mirror of our type of training, right?
Right.
But I said my 65, 800 squat, 1880 total. I promised a world record in a year.
Right.
In 1 year, squats 890, world record. And he totaled 2080. That's the 4th biggest total of all. That's what we wanted to total, and that's what we totaled.
Right.
And got more in them. And so we always make a plan like that, but it's exactly the same. Exactly. You're doing great. And like you said, she does all the assistance.
All the assistance.
My guys, the more assistance they do, it's my strongest guys.
Yeah, she'll go multiple times. She's lifting anywhere between 6 and 10 times every single week. Way more than the other people. She just has got number one, her work ethic is higher. And number two, she just listens better than the other guys. It's crazy. And she's going to probably go to the Olympics.
You know what I see with the squat? Now, if you look, there's his name, the 150 to 70K Chinese kid. He's enormously strong.
He's talking about Lu Zhaozhong. Yeah.
He, I watched him in front squat of 573. He's got a 457 clean as so far. Okay. Now, Nam Suleiman had a 435 clean years ago at 132, and he routinely squatted 528, books I've read. So look at that ratio. But mostly in this country, they front squat 10 pounds more than they clean.
That's not what we're trying to do.
Exactly.
Yeah, we're trying to be strong. Everyone thinks that our gym is on steroids, but we just actually work hard.
Yeah, that's a compliment.
I do. Thanks, you guys. And so, but yeah, our guys are all strong. Jackie's very strong. She squatted, this is a high bar Olympic style, 341 at 63 kilos. So.
Of course, I've been accused by this. A major team just came here. I went a year ago and talked to them. It's a national team sport. I won't say who it is. They looked at me, and I know what you're thinking. And, we're going to come down here, and I'm going to give them something. That's how we get strong. Well, then they sent their son down here. And he works out. And the coach came down, and the coach apologized. And he bought $20,000 of equipment. They found out there's a little bit more going on here than what they think.
I know, man. It's so stupid. I mean, even me as a powerlifter, I broke records in the IPF, the USA Powerlifting, USPF. I went wherever. I'm just trying to be the strongest. So, yeah, that's stupid. If you think it's all about drugs, I follow this stuff. I'll beat anyone. If I want to, I'll come back and beat them now. I mean, and I'll follow his methods.
Well, I want to bring up a point because, we know – why do people take anabolic steroids? Because it makes you stronger and it makes you recovery. My system – is the greatest, I believe, the greatest strength system in the world. I mean, I've had, I wrote a book review for Dr. Verfashansky. I did seminars for with Super Training, Mel Siff. So a lot of people think, Dr. Zasazorsky said, I've got a 99%. And, and so it's pretty, these people, and Dr.
As Romanoff, a compliment.
Dr. Romanoff, a running expert, thinks this is the greatest thing since, Russia. And so that's
but
a compliment to me.
But the weightlifting coaches don't.
Exactly. That's what I don't understand.
But wait, we're losing.
But what I'm saying is, so if you can't take anabolics, I have the greatest strength training in the world. Why wouldn't you do the strength training?
Seriously. You said this morning it was the next best thing. But you know what? You just made a great point. As weightlifting coaches, and I'll be the first to admit, I complain too. We complain about the other countries taking steroids. Well, if being stronger is not important, then why would people even take anabolic steroids?
Okay.
To make their technique better? Mm-hmm. No, it doesn't do that.
No.
Makes them stronger.
You know, my rap is, see, like, I don't want to, I'm not criticizing. I never will criticize. I barely got out of high school. I wrote more books than I've ever read. Not really, but.
That's not true. Yeah. I've seen a bunch here.
But, you know, I realize a lot of things. I lost my concentration, but I realize a lot of things about training. And, you know, it's not what people think it is.
No, it's definitely not. No, it's awesome. It's, what we did today was awesome. So
I finally come to senses here. You know, everybody, the weightlifters would complain about competing with everybody else, and they can't get a person qualified for the Olympics. But yet, we dominate in gymnastics. We dominate in swimming. Beach volleyball. Name every sport.
Track
we dominate.
Track and field, swimming, gymnastics, everything.
And I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings.
Basketball.
But this is how I look at it. If you got a great team, you got a great coach. You got a bad team, you got a suck coach.
That's true. And that's why I'm here.
I hope it can change the face of America. I love Olympic weightlifting. And I'm going like, why can't we have a medal? It's just insane that we don't. We compete against that. We compete against the Finns, the Russians, everybody. We beat all their asses. We compete against worldwide. You've been to WPO.
Right. Yeah.
It's everybody. Everybody's everybody. And who wins? Westside.
Yeah. Well, Travis too. Well, I guess I'm Westside.
Right, exactly, he beat the Westside.
Yeah,
but
I used your methods.
But one of our guys beat you.
Yeah, you know, I was hoping you wouldn't remember that. But Joe Bales. Is that right. What you're talking about? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but you know what I'm saying.
Son of a gun.
But that's like I said, iron sharpens iron.
Yeah.
I when Travis lifted, I wanted him to get better because the better he gets, the better my guys got
to
get.
You're always super good.
Get better. My guys wouldn't have to get better.
Right. Chuck Vogelpohl made me better. Like, I saw the videos. If you think I wasn't watching those videos, you're crazy. I was watching them, and I was sleeping at night, almost bit my teeth in two, grinding my teeth. I was so angry that he was stronger than me until I was, you know, better than him. And so then he would try to beat me, and then Joe Bales did. He got lucky, but. it was, oh my gosh, there was a point I was going to make. Okay, here's my point. And so the biggest, you know, criticism that they'll give is like, what does Louie Simmons know about weightlifting? Sure. Can he teach snatch and clean and jerk? I'm not saying he can do that. I'm much better. Like this morning, he was putting us through his methods. And, you know, Jackie was doing it, and I was coaching her technique. I was, you know, we made some, you know, she missed only one time all morning. It was just a technical flaw. I taught to her, and then she went on to break it two more times. And so, but here's the thing. You know, they don't, from the Carolina Panthers, don't come to him to learn how to play football. You know, the
Jags, half the NFL team.
Dallas Cowboys, Ohio State. They weren't here this morning to say, hey, will you teach us how to sprint or teach us how to throw the shot? They're saying, can you teach us how to get stronger? Can you teach us how to be more explosive? Can you teach, you know, we have this weakness. Can you, you know, give us an idea how to overcome this weakness? That's where you guys are missing the point, man. And, like, I'm talking to my buddies now. Like, I'm talking to my friends. I know I'm jacked up on coffee and I've, you know, criticized you guys. But the truth is, a lot of you dudes are my best of friends that I'm talking to. You know, get past the fact of snatching clean and jerk. You guys have got to get past that when I say this now. Like, it's not about him trying to teach you snatch and clean and jerk. It's about him trying to give you anything. If you can learn one little thing, man, that's something that you can use to make your athletes better. And if you don't listen, you know, don't blame anyone else for your athletes sucking so bad. Like, if a guy like Joe Ken, who was two times in a row voted the number one strength coach in the entire world, if that guy will spend his time to come up here multiple times to learn something, don't you think that all of us can learn something from this guy? Because I know I have learned a million things in 2 days. So I was just kidding when I've been, you know, throwing down so much on you. I'm all hyped up. And, you know, my wife says I'm being a jerk because I feel like I was when I was a kid again. I promise you I'll come back down to earth. And so, but please learn. So.
My books actually basically have a disclaimer. I tell you that I don't know Olympic weightlifting technique, but that doesn't matter. You're adequate with weightlifting technique. You're way subpar with the strength.
Right.
I'm writing a track book. Now, I've trained two Olympic gold medalists. The only thing that runs on me is my nose and my mouth. I don't know how to, I do basically know how to run. I say I'm not a technical track coach. I have a lot of technical things by top track people. They get the credit for it. But in track, there's too many injuries. And I show people how not to get injured and how to run fast, and it works. I just had two people in Olympic trials. You know, and yeah. One's in the hurdles. No, I cannot do hurdles. And the other was in the 400.
You but look like a hurdler. At 5 foot five, you look like a great hurdler.
Yeah.
About as good as me.
Life's a hurdler to me, dude.
Yeah. Yeah, no doubt. No doubt. So today has been great. I'm seeing if we've... Oh, one of the points that he made is you can say, look, I've been up here, and in 2 days, I've got all these notes. And so there might be one or two things to learn. But one of the things you talked about is, like, you know, the best way. We all, even a lot of you guys talk about this already. The best way to get stronger is to increase volume. You got to do it somewhere. And, like, you can't just say, I'm going to snatch and clean and jerk more and more and more. But, like, using, you know, the accessory movements, the machines you've talked about, that is the way, a very healthy way to get stronger. And the cool thing about what we did today, like the reverse hyper, it's not going to leave Jackie beat up tomorrow. Literally, she will feel better tomorrow.
Because it's traction. You know, I wrote about Leonard Zasatinsky, the Olympic champion in 1664, you know, the Soviet. And he broke all these records, and all of a sudden he didn't go anywhere, and he couldn't understand why. And he got in his logbook, and he realized that his average weight intensity percentage was slightly down, and his volume had slipped down. So they pushed it back to where it went was before and went right back to breaking records. That's how important it is.
Yeah.
And in 1996, one of the guys that's helping the Olympics down there, he's talking to me on the phone, you know. I don't remember his name, unfortunately.
You're just like me. I'm terrible with names.
Yeah, he goes, I know we don't know how to squat because we squat all the time and right. We can't squat. And he said, you guys squat one or two times a week and you're world record holders in the squat.
Right.
And I go, and what I watch, I've heard some people, we squat six times a week. Well, you squat like Girl Scouts. What's good's it doing you? You know,
yeah.
You'd be a lot better off to pull a sled or
right.
Do our restoration work walking in the bell squat like some of your athletes
right.
Did. And only squat twice. One workout must be for super speed.
Right.
And one must be for max effort.
Right.
Anything else doesn't matter. You know, like I talk about my sprinters, and a lot of sprint coaches have people run at 80, 85, 90%. Why would you do that? The definition of a sprint in Webster's Dictionary is to run as fast as possible for a short distance. If you had a race car, it went 100 miles an hour in the eighth.
Right.
Why would you take it to the track and go 90, 95, 85? You'd want to go 101, 102.
Right.
And so you want to go all out. That's what max effort is. A max effort means one. Max effort is singular, not plural. When you do heavy triples, it builds strength endurance. Constantly work. And I want to bring up another point that we're going to do tomorrow. We're going to do a lot of special exercise, right?
All right, yeah.
Isometrics. Yeah. You have to do isometrics.
I'm glad you brought that up.
When the bar gets to the first pole and the barbell basically does it won't go any farther, and you do the second pole, as it slows down, quasi, where it's barely moving, it becomes isometric. That's where the greatest muscular force has to be exerted,
right.
And you can't do it.
Right.
So, or if you watch Jackie, for instance, she'll bang the bar out of there so fast with 1/100th of a second.
Yeah.
So if she did 5 lifts, she's getting 5 1/100th of a second work there.
Right.
But if she did 5 holds for 4 seconds, she'd get 20 seconds of work at the most critical point. Like
right.
The Chinese do a lot of pulls from that area off boxes.
Right. Which we do too. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
But my point is, you got to work in these dead areas. That's where you got to put the work.
Right. And anyone, if you're not doing isometrics, you're crazy, because isometrics, undoubtedly proven through research, will strengthen the joint of that, you know, the angle of the, you know, of the joint that you're working more than any other, more than concentric, more than eccentric. Isometrics will strengthen that portion of the movement.
If we want to test anyone's strength, it's tested isometrically. That's how it's tested.
Right.
Strength is measured isometrically.
Awesome. So I know you got, you know, Aaron's filming. I don't want you to stay too long. There was one more point I want to cover is that with weightlifting. Now here, you cannot deny what we're about to say now is that if we really want American weightlifting to get better, we're going to have to learn to get into, you know, the community better. We got to learn to recruit, you know, at a younger age, you know, the best that we can. Now, there are, you know, outliers like Jackie, or even, you know, you can talk about Klokov. He started at a much, you know, he's one of, you know, one of the few Russians who started, you know, a little bit later in life. But, like, the goal is to get these kids started, you know, at younger ages. And I'm probably not going to give my ideas away on this, but we're coming up with something really cool that we're going to do. You know, he's helping me with, giving me the ideas that we're going to do to, you know, get the kids involved, and you should do the same thing.
Yeah, you know, coaches, I don't want to beat a dead horse, but you know about the technique thing. My guy Tommy shows me, I get on the internet and I watch all the things. It's where I learn all these things, watching the old tapes and new tapes and so forth. And there was a Chinese kid. He's, I think he was 7, 8 years old. And he weighed 67 pounds, and he clean jerked 167 pounds.
Yeah.
Okay. So if an 8-year-old child is doing these lifts, it can't be that complicated.
Yeah.
Get this out of your head. You know, it's not a beauty contest. It's not gymnastics or ice skating where you start at a number and you subtract. It's who lifts the most weights.
Yeah.
And I'm into technique because I've got good friends that are secondary black belt in jiu-jitsu. You know, Carlos Carvelli trains all kind of MMA guys, like Cowboy Cerrone. It goes on. Matt Brown, it goes on.
Even you, with the way you coach, you know, squats, and you're very big on technique. I mean, you were coaching the heck out of them on technique. So we're not saying it's not important, but...
Technique is absolutely important. But, you know, I talked to a coach. I won't bring up his name. I said, what do you do during the week? Well, I do this, that, this. He got the third year. We work on technique. I go, what? Yeah, we go in there and we do this on technique. A real weightlifter learns technique at 8 and 10 years old. Yeah. You never work on technique again. You were talking about him. Yeah. He just works on strength. Yeah. You learn the freaking – it's like a bike. Once you learn it, you can ride it. You can ride it forever.
Right.
Not to be done when you're 19 years old.
If we're not careful, we're going to put it into the minds of our lifters that the lifts are much harder than they are. If all we say is like, oh, the technique, or you're off, you know, 1 millimeter. I mean, like, man, just lift, dude. Lift. When I talked to Klokov, and I asked him, I'm like, you know, what is the technique that the Russians, you know, teach? Or, you know, do you guys go over position 1, 2, and 3? And he laughed. He's like, no, I did that in the first 2 years, and then we just got strong. That's coming from Klokov. I mean, that's coming, and that's not him giving me a seminar like he gives you guys. That's us sitting down as friends and having a few drinks, and then him saying that. The truth.
That's what Ben Tabasnik will tell you if you read the Soviet sports recovery books. It's exactly how it has to be done. All sports were done the same way. And in 1921, their term was polished. If you wasn't polished, you were gone.
Right.
You know? And over here, like you were talking, everyone doesn't start the second pole at the same position on their legs because you have different torso lengths, different leg lengths, and different arm lengths.
Yeah.
So you can't say there's a perfect technique. You just can't.
Amen. There is no perfect technique.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, I talk to top track coaches all the time. You know, I got great rapport with top track coaches. And this is what they say. Because the two greatest runners in the world from 100 meters to 4 is Johnson and Bolt. Johnson runs straight up and down, short stride. Bolt's very tall, normally tall, and makes very long strides. He covers the track in 41 steps instead of 43 to 45 like everyone else. All right. How do they excel? Strength.
Right.
Because track running, 90% of you have to run down the track is just overcome gravity vertically. Only 10% to go down the track. So those two men were exceptionally strong, and so they had tremendous ground force, minimal ground contact, and then their strides was absolutely differently, but they were totally
Michael
different.
Michael Johnson could squat over 500 pounds.
They were totally different technique, but they were the greatest. So what you do, you work on technique, but don't change their style, and that's the last thing I'll say.
That was a great show. Thank you so much for being on the show. I've said it before, but this is by far, at least whether you guys think it's the best show or not, I had the most fun, so I'm happy. Thanks.